Good evening, everyone. My name is Rick Bowers. Between Laura Nickman and myself, we'll be moderating and hosting the event this evening. Thank you all for coming out. We're looking forward to a vigorous debate. I'm sure you all are here to determine who will get your vote, who will earn your vote. We are in the only county that I know of in the state that has complete Republican representation. We want to keep it that way, but we want to make sure that we have the best Republicans out there. We have no shortage of talent. This evening will demonstrate that for you, and we're looking forward to being a part of that. Thank you again for showing up. If you could make sure you silence your cell phones, that would help us quite a bit. We're being videotaped this evening by Queen Anne's County TV, which will be broadcast on their website as well as their cable channel starting, I believe, on Saturday. So please be sure to visit there, and you can see their website is QACTV.org starting Saturday. So once again, thank you so much for your attendance here, and we're just ready to get started. Voters, including Republican voters, are not pleased with Republicans' control of both chambers of Congress this past year. Just 19% of Republican voters think Congress performed better now that both House of Representatives and a Senate are run by GOP, according to Rasmussen, December 15. Republicans have generally been critical of Congress this year, as Democrats and unaffiliated voters are. Many GOP voters are outraged that the Republican-controlled Congress has allowed President Obama to control, to close his presidential term with no major setbacks to his policies that he has enacted or authorized through executive order. He has also approved a $1.1 trillion budget that Obama administration says funded all their priorities, including Syrian refugee resettlement program, funding for Planned Parenthood, and implementation of Obamacare.
This dissatisfaction with Congress is manifesting itself in support of Republican voters for outsider and anti-establishment presidential candidates like Donald Trump and Ted Cruz, and likely will result in the realignment of the GOP. It's the goal of the Queen Anne's County Republican Central Committee to facilitate a healthy and vigorous debate on the issues. Our constituents are strong Republican supporters and deserve your best tonight. This is your opportunity to tell the voters of District 1 how you will be part of the solution and not the status quo in Washington, D.C. Before we begin the questions, you each will be afforded a one-minute introduction period, please.
We're also going to utilize a very familiar debate process that you may have seen throughout the presidential campaigns. We are going to give each candidate a one-minute introduction time. When asked a question, they'll have 1 minute to respond. If another candidate's name is mentioned, then that candidate will have 30 seconds to rebut. So we're hoping for a lively, vigorous debate. I've told the gentlemen to have their A game tonight, and I believe they've brought it, so let's get started. We've heard Republican Congress members become bemoaning that the president and Democrats will not work within the limits of their constitutional powers, but there isn't much a rogue administration can accomplish without Congress's approval and authorization to spend. The framers of the Constitution regarded the power of the purse as, quote, the most complete and effectual weapon with which any Constitution can arm the immediate representatives of the people for obtaining a redress of every grievance and for carrying into effect every just and salutary measure. As such, the Constitution requires that all bills for raising revenue originate in the House, the branch of Congress that is closest and most dependent upon the people. Your question, and we'll start with Mr. Jackson. If elected to Congress, will you use the full authority of your office to restrain federal government spending, including sequestration and shutdowns?
In regards to the question of shutdowns, you hate to put anybody out of work, but we have to balance the budget. We have to finally put a hold to it, what's going on. Spending is out of control with Obama. He's got us almost close to $20 trillion in deficit. And ultimately, it's just going to destroy our children and their ability to pay the debt that we're now spending on their behalf before they've had the opportunity to even pay taxes. We definitely got to control the spending. That's without a doubt is going to be a priority. That's all I got for right this second.
Okay. I neglected to have the opening statements, so I tell you what. Why don't we have them now, And then we'll go back to that question. Mr. Jackson, thank you very much for your answer. So let's, and thank you for your forgiveness. So let's start with Congressman Harrison and come back to you at the end, Mr. Jackson. Go ahead.
Vote for the opening statement.
Pardon?
For the opening statement?
Yes.
All right.
Thank you for
clarifying.
We're back
on track. Look, when I came before you in 2008 and unsuccessfully, and in 2010 successfully, I told you I'd go to Washington and I'd represent a conservative philosophy that I think the majority of the voters in the first district share. And I believe that's what I did. I delivered on my promises. And you're going to hear that from some people, perhaps, that I didn't. But I urge you to go to objective measures. The Heritage Action, go to heritageaction.com. I'm the 15th most conservative member of the House. I belong to the Freedom Caucus, the 42 most conservative members of the House, the ones who, I'll remind you, convinced Mr. Boehner to take an early retirement. And if you go to ivoteguide.com, simple, ivoteguide.com, it's a compilation. I am the very conservative candidate, and everyone else is somewhat conservative or less. So if you want to send a principled conservative to Congress, you did it before, I'm going to ask you to do it again. Thank you.
Mr. Goff.
Hi, everybody. My name is Jonathan Goff. I'm from Harford County, Maryland, and I worked at Bethlehem Steel for 15 years, and I was also a business owner for over 20 years. So I know what it's like to be on both sides of the ship, being union on one side and a business owner, independent business owner on the other side. Now, the other thing that I wanted to say is I am just as mad as everybody else in this room about what Congress has done and how they have failed us. Now, we sent these guys to Washington to be honest and to listen to the constituents, listen to us, we the people. And it seems to me like they just let us down. And they flipped on us, and then they caved into Obama. And yes, I will use the power of the purse. And I will do what it takes to maintain our budget and not spend more than we're supposed to, because our children are going to be paying for this, and their grandchildren. Thank you.
Mr. Smigel.
Thank you, sir. My name is Michael Smigel. I spent 12 years in the Maryland House of Delegates representing this district very proudly and humbly. I thank you for giving me that opportunity. When there, I was one of the most effective that's been in the legislature. I'm able to maintain principle and get things accomplished. I got more bills passed in the legislature by still maintaining my principles than any other Republican there. I was the chairman and founder of the Tea Party Caucus in the Maryland House of Delegates. When Martin O'Malley exceeded his governmental authority, violated the Constitution, as an attorney of 27 years, I sued him. I took him to court. And it's the same thing you should do when you're in Congress and you have an executive that goes and uses extra powers that are not in Article 1, Section 8 of the Constitution and what the government is allowed to do. So I ask you to look at my record. You will see that there is no one more conservative than I am here or in the race for the Congressional First District. Thank you.
And Mr. Jackson, your opening statement, sir.
Good evening. Thanks for coming. Again, my name is Sean Jackson. I'm from Harford County. I've served 25 years of public service. I served 6 years in the United States Marine Corps, an additional 19 and a half years with the Maryland State Police. I run a grassroots campaign. I have no special interest groups, political action committees, or lobbyists that I'm tied in with. I'm just like everybody else. 83% of Americans are dissatisfied with Congress. I, too, am one of them. I just want to go to Congress and do what's right. I want to represent the working class. It's tough right now in society, you know, tough for jobs, tough to keep the money in your pocket when it's the money's being spent lavishly up in Congress, and we need to find a better way. And I'd like to have that representation go there and represent you and I. Again, it's our seat, and we need to work together. Thank you.
Thank you. And we'll start with Mr. Harris, the question that I originally had asked to Mr. Jackson out of order. If elected to Congress, or in your case, re-elected to Congress, will you use the full authority of your office to restrain federal government spending, including sequestration and shutdowns?
Sure. You know, my record's clear. It's interesting. There's a lot of frustration out there. Say, look, we control the House. You know, the House is where spending bills originate. How come we can't defund everything? And many of you know, remember the sticker, right, from 2010, the Fire Pelosi sticker. We fired Nancy Pelosi. We control the House. But although we have a majority in the Senate, we don't really control it because of the filibuster rule. Harry Reid still just he's a shill for the president, and he uses the rules of the filibuster in the Senate to protect the president. So we still have Harry Reid, and we still have Barack Obama. The spending bills, you know, I'm the most conservative person on the Appropriations Committee. I went down there and figured, if you want to change this, because you're right, what you got to do is you got to start in the appropriations in the House. So I got appointed to the Appropriations Committee, the most conservative member on the committee, who votes to restrict spending in the House. We pass those bills, Senate doesn't take them up, and the president just will never sign what we pass out of the House. We have got to change the presidency. That's what this election is all about.
Thank you, Mr. Goff.
Like I said, we will use the power of the purse, and if it takes shutting down a small portion of the non-essential part of the government to make sure that this administration, the next administration, does not overstep its boundaries on the American people, we got to do what we got to do for the American people. It seems to me like Washington has completely forgot about us. They say one thing before they get elected, and then after they get elected, they go down there and they do whatever they want. And we're tired of it. And if it comes to shutting down that portion, we will have to do what we got to do.
Thank you. Mr. Smigel?
Absolutely. I will do anything and everything necessary to make sure that the government operates within the constraints of the Constitution. That's the only thing we make a pledge to, and Article 1, Section 8 sets out exactly what it is that the Constitution should, how they should operate. Now, with respect to why I'm here, I feel betrayed. I feel betrayed by those who went down there and made us all the right promises and said all the right things, but then they made the wrong votes. How can you be a conservative? How can you be a member of a Liberty Caucus when you cram everything into a bill that's impossible to be read, a cromnomous bill, and instead of using the power of the purse and saying, you know what, we're going to take these up one at a time, and being afraid that somebody might point the finger at you as a Republican and say, you shut down government, and instead saying, go ahead, Mr. President, go ahead, we will fully fund Obamacare. Go ahead, Mr. President, we'll fund that illegal, unconstitutional amnesty for tens of millions of illegals. That was all in that cromnomous bill, including federal funding for expanding abortion. You don't, as a conservative, vote to put that through. You read the bills. I read my bills.
Thank you.
Gentlemen, the next question is about religious liberties. The rights of Americans to live and work in accordance with their religious beliefs is increasingly under assault, especially from burdensome government policies. For example, many provisions of Obamacare weaken family choice of coverage, undermine parental participation in minor children's health care decisions, and undercut family values in health care. The law's anti-conscience mandate forces countless religious organizations, family businesses, and other employers to provide health plans that include coverage of abortion-inducing drugs, contraception, and sterilization, regardless of their religious or moral objections. The question for you is, will you be willing to enact permanent protections for individuals, families, employers, and insurers to keep them from being forced to offer, provide, or pay for services that violate their deeply held beliefs? Mr. Goff, would you begin, please?
Well, this is what happens when we have open borders and the government's just letting everybody into this country. We're going to get all kind of different religions. And yes, I will protect the employers. And I'm telling you, this has gotten it so out of control. It's like the Tower of Babel. You know, where all these people built this tower to reach heaven, but nobody could understand each other. And that's where we're at right now. I want English to be the primary language to be in America. And our American values are starting to fade away. And I want to preserve that. Let's keep it that way. We can't even say Merry Christmas anymore. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Smeagol.
Thank you. Yes, I absolutely will protect religious liberties. As I said, this is the only thing I owe any allegiance to when I go there, and that's the U.S. Constitution. The First Amendment grants that. But part of this problem is from Republicans themselves, because we are hypocritical when we say we want the 10th Amendment, but we don't want the states to go out and figure out these issues on their own, and we want to come up with some solution at the federal level. Utah did it right. You know what Utah did? Utah took the gay rights and they took the religious rights and put them in the same bill. And they said, guess what? You're going to figure it out. And they protected religious liberties when they passed that bill. So all the religious liberties were protected, because if you didn't, you didn't get the bill through. So they actually, the states' rights worked. Following the Constitution, letting the 10th Amendment and the states work on it, got it done. So yes, I'll protect religious liberties, and I will look for a federal bill. I don't have any problem with that. But I would say, look to the Constitution first and see that it can be done by adhering to states' rights. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Jackson.
Hey, yes, I agree with protecting everyone's First Amendment rights. I do have concerns when the government, if you have a federal job or a state job and they enact certain laws and want to enforce their type of rights at that level, again, I'm against it, but I understand why they do what they do to try to be politically correct. But when it comes to small businesses and you have your political background, you have your ideology, you have your personal feelings, and for the government to go into your small business and infringe on you and force you to go against your religious beliefs on behalf of an employee or a future employee, then I'm against it totally.
Thank you. Mr. Harris.
Thanks. Thanks for the question being asked, because it didn't come up at the League of Women Voters Forum. Look, the fact of the matter is I'm going to ask you to send me back to Congress, because that's what I've been doing. I signed onto the amicus brief of the Supreme Court in the religious freedom case. I'm a co-sponsor of the Religious Freedom Act. I've sponsored a riders in the appropriations bill sitting on the Appropriations Committee that dealt with religious freedom. That's why the Family Research Council supports me for re-election, because they know I delivered on what I said I'd go to Washington and do. But I will tell you, it's not the House race that's important if you believe in religious freedom in Maryland. It's the Senate race, because this will depend on the Supreme Court. They heard the Little Sisters of the Poor case. My bet is going to come up 4-4, and it's going to be back in front of the Supreme Court. We better have a Scalia-type justice, and the only way we get it is control of the Senate. So take a close look at the Senate race in the state. It's an open seat race. Make sure that the person you send to Washington supports you on this issue and supports your belief on this issue. Thank you.
Thank you. We're going to move on and have a budget question. In 2015, the national debt reached $18.8 trillion and exceeded 100% of everything the economy produced in goods and services as defined by the gross domestic product, GDP. High federal debt puts the United States at risk for a number of harmful economic consequences, including slower economic growth, a weakened ability to respond to unexpected challenges, and a possibly debt-driven financial crisis. Deficits are on the rise again, beginning in 2016, within a decade, they're projected to exceed $1 trillion annually. The Congressional Budget Office projects that interest on the debt alone will exceed the national defense budget, not including spending on war or other emergencies, before the end of this decade. The Budget Control Act of 2011 and sequestration were modestly restraining the discretionary budget, but Congress continues to compromise these tools and overspend at an unsustainable rate. The questions for you, sirs, as a member of Congress, how will you cut or cap spending to help avoid a Greece-style financial meltdown? And we'll begin with Mr. Smeagol, please.
Well, first, I would never go in, and you look at the 2014 Cromnibus bill, and what did it do? The largest tax increase in history. What do they do in 2015? Let's lift the debt ceiling. We're not even going to have one. So we can go as far as we want in debt. What we need to do, as I said earlier, is Article 1, Section 8 of the Constitution, and it limits what... There is no reason at all that we have a federal board of education. We don't need that. You don't need to have the federal controlling the environmental laws and putting out regulations that affect our business and being able to prosper. You can get rid of those. You can return it to the states where they can take care of it locally. Power locally is best. And there's nowhere in the Constitution that they have the authority from any of these departments. The housing, get rid of those. Cut those expenses and make it so that the businesses don't have the boot of big government on their neck, keeping them from being able to prosper and grow. And that's where you start. Thank you.
Mr. Jackson.
Well, right now, the government's spending 20% on welfare. We're spending 18% on national defense. I think we need to at least address that and revamp the welfare system and all the fraud that's built into the system. We need to work with big government in getting it reduced. Education, VA, IRS, EPA are just some of the ones that we need to reduce significantly. In regards to education, we could bring that back to states' rights rather than the government dictating how nationally we should educate our children. We need to entice big corporations to keep their product and keep their businesses here in the United States to build that tax base by keeping people working. What I'd like to see is the corporate tax to reduced and have a flat business tax at around 16%. That'd be more conducive for the businesses to stay here in the country and again, create a better tax level for us so that we have a greater federal income. And if we could have a fair flat tax, that'd be wonderful too in regards to personal income.
Thank you. Mr. Harris.
There's no question that our debt and our deficit is a huge issue. You know, whether we're talking about our ability to fund national defense or our ability to stimulate the economy, the debt is a drag on both of those. But I will tell you that we have to remember, when we fired Nancy Pelosi, the national deficit, the federal annual deficit, was $1.3 trillion a year. And it's gone down every year until last year. And I've supported it going down every year till last year, and I voted for it. I voted for both the Republican budgets that helped bring it down, as well as the RSC budgets that would have brought it down further. But when the bipartisan budget agreement, also called the Boehner budget agreement, came out last year, which actually increased the deficit for the first time in 6 years, I voted against it. Because I told you I would go to Washington and vote to decrease the deficit and get us on a path to repay the debt. It's exactly what I did. And when they stopped doing that last year, I stopped voting for it. And I've led the fight this year against maintaining that level without finding cuts elsewhere. We have got to control that debt and deficit.
And Mr. Goff.
What they're not talking about is all the illegals, how much they cost us. And they're costing us a lot of money. Anchor babies. This has got to stop. We got to stop these anchor babies because they're not legal citizens. If they're from another country and they come to America and they have a child, it doesn't make them an American citizen. And next thing you know, they're bringing the entire family over to the United States. Obamacare. We got to get rid of Obamacare. This is going to cost us a fortune. The numbers don't add up, and everybody knows it. I would like us to have a free enterprise system. Let capitalism work. And I'll tell you that we'll have a choice of our own health care, and we'll save money, and we'll get a health care that's good for us. Thank you.
Thank you, gentlemen. The next question is related to budget. A little bit different. There's a long-standing broad consensus that federal taxpayer funds should not be used for elective abortions or for health insurance that includes abortion coverage. However, during the 2013 to 2014 reporting year alone, Planned Parenthood affiliates performed over 327,000 abortions and reports that it, with its affiliates, received over $528 million in government funding, which amounts to 41% of the organization's total revenues. In addition to its provision of abortion services, Planned Parenthood affiliates face accusations of waste, abuse, potential fraud with taxpayer dollars, failure to report the sexual abuse of minor girls, and allegations of profiting from the sale of organs from aborted babies. Nevertheless, the current Republican-led Congress again approved funding for Planned Parenthood in the 2016 budget. Your question, gentlemen. If given the privilege to serve the people, both born and unborn, in Congress, what means would you use to ensure that no further public funds are appropriated for abortion mills? Question starts with Mr. Jackson.
Okay. Well, I'm pro-life, and when it comes to abortions, I don't believe we should have them. I understand there's certain situations where there's incest, rape, that they talk about. But when it comes to funding and paying for that, I don't believe a single penny should come out of federal tax money. Those are situations where, yes, you've been victimized, but that is something that's private, that should be between the victim and the doctor in a private setting. Not for the federal government to be in the middle of that doctor's office and opening up the wallet to pay for these type of, basically, it's sanctioned murders. With Planned Parenthood, again, as I spoke with earlier, there is fraud in a lot of different forms of government, and the subsidies that we provide, that's again, is another thing that we need to be looking at significantly, because all that is coming out of our money, and at $19 trillion, we can't afford to keep doing these type of programs. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Harris, please.
Look, I'm a leader in the pro-life among the pro-life members in the House, and you don't have to take my word. I'm the one endorsed by National Right to Life. I'm the one endorsed by Maryland Right to Life. We defunded Planned Parenthood in the committee in the House, and it was put back in the Senate when they reconciled the bill, the omnibus bill last year, and I voted against the omnibus bill last year. The fact of the matter is I voted for the reconciliation bill. We defunded Planned Parenthood. We abolished Obamacare, sent it to the president's desk, and the president vetoed it. What can we say? Go back to my initial comments. We need a new president. I'm one of the only 8 Republicans appointed to what we call the Special Investigative Panel on Infant Lives, which is that special investigative panel that's meeting to look into the sale of baby body parts from Planned Parenthood clinics. One of only 8 because of my record. We're going to meet next week, and I will tell you, stay tuned. We have evidence that what Planned Parenthood said is a lie. They are not just getting expenses when they charge, they're making profits on those sales. And like I said, this is an important issue and it hasn't gone away. We're going to investigate it until we prove what we know is true. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Harris. Mr. Goff.
I'm a right to life person, and no federal money should go towards any abortions. I believe in protecting all of our children at conception, and it's going to stay that way. And if it's in any bills to spend any money, federal monies for abortions, then this bill is not even going to reach the floor for a vote. Now, I can't see why they're going to talk about the Cromness bill, the H.R. 3547 bill that funded Obamacare. They're going to talk about all this. But what I'm going to say to you is these bills should not even have reached the floor for a vote. And they should have stopped these bills from the very start. So, yes, I will stop any monies being spent on any kind of abortions. Thank you.
Mr. Smigel.
Thank you. I went to CPAC this year. And so you understand my credentials, I have a 100% rating from Maryland Right to Life for every year that I've been in the legislature, 12 years. Got 100% rating. The only regulations that have ever been placed on abortion clinics in Maryland were the result of the bills I put in to make sure that they were regulated. They went to summer study, came back and regulated them. When I went to the CPAC, I went up to the executive director of policy for Planned Parenthood nationally and said, why is it you did not count that the Crown Limits Bill of 2014 and those who voted for it actually expanded federally funded abortion for the first time to Peace Corps workers? She said, I didn't read the bill. I asked her why, when my representative had voted for the H.R. 2722, which gave $4.7 million to Planned Parenthood, why didn't you count that against them? She said, well, we didn't count that bill. And so when you go and you ask them why the ones who are supposed to be doing it, you have to point them out and call them out, because they're running cover for those who will do what they want. These organizations don't always give you the facts.
I think I'm Mr. Smeagol's representative.
Yes, you have 30 seconds.
Let me just read a letter from National Right to Life Committee that deals with the accusation that I somehow voted for federal funds to pay for abortion. It quotes Mr. Smeagol as saying in a town hall in Elkton that I voted for federal funds to pay for abortion. This is their quote from their letter. This charge is utterly false. To put the most charitable interpretation upon Mr. Smeagol's statement, he is grossly misinformed. Fact of the matter is, I'm proud of my pro-life record. I'm not ashamed of it. I said, when you sent me to Washington, you're sending a pro-life person to Washington. And all I can say is, Mr. Smeagol is grossly misinformed.
Thank you, Mr. Smeagol. You have 30 seconds, yes.
Amazing. The very woman, I tell you, does not count his vote and doesn't read the bill. He reads a letter from saying, I'm okay. Well, guess what? Every one of you, get on Google, because you can't hide from the real facts when you go look them up. So you go look up Crown Limits Bill 2014, federally funded abortion, you're going to find out the congressman voted for it. And so when he just sat here and told you that he didn't, you'll see for yourself. And you can also look up the bill I gave you, which was the H.R. 2722, 2015.
Thank you. And we're going to move on.
Excuse me, I think he mentioned me in the answer twice.
Well, that's true.
And I guarantee I won't mention anyone else in mine. How's that?
Make it very brief, sir.
My record is clear. Go to the National Right to Life site. Look at it. Be your own judge. Look at who sits on that special investigative panel for infant lives. Who got appointed to that panel? Make up your own mind. Thank you.
Thank you. Moving on to another budget question regarding entitlement spending. Over the 75-year-long term horizon, the combined unfunded obligations arising from the promised benefits of Medicare and Social Security alone exceed $50 trillion. The federal unfunded obligations arising from Medicaid and even from veterans benefits are unknown, but would likely add many trillions more to this figure. By some estimates, the United States federal government's combined unfunded obligations already exceed $200 trillion in today's dollars. Figures such as these are simply unfathomable. The Affordable Care Act, or Obamacare, further adds to the problem, increasing entitlement spending by nearly $2 trillion in just 10 years. Your question: if elected, how would you propose Congress reform or restructure these programs to keep within budget and protected from insolvency? And we will begin with Mr. Harris.
Sure. Look, I voted for Mr. Ryan's budget blueprint for the past 4 years shows exactly how it's planned to be done. It goes to balance within 10 years. One interesting thing is the president's budget that he submits every year never, ever, ever, ever balances. In fact, the one he submitted this year increases the federal deficit over the next 10 years to $1 trillion again. You can't do that in your household, but the president obviously thinks he can do it to this country. The fact of the matter is, we actually propose how we change Social Security and how we change Medicare, preserving benefits for those people who are near retirement, and yet allowing the younger generation to go to a new style system that actually will preserve it for them. Because as I tell many people, I have a 34-year-old son who's an accountant. You ask him if he thinks he's ever going to get Social Security, Medicare, he says no. He works with numbers all day. Anybody who looks at the figures knows we have to reform it. And we shouldn't change it for anyone in a near retirement, but we have to begin changing it for those who are younger so that we preserve it for the future.
Thank you. Mr. Goff?
Well, we all know that they went crazy with America's credit card. $19 trillion. That's the world's biggest debt. How did they get us in this mess? We have the Senate and we have the House. And they could have stopped Obama with the power of the purse at any time. And did they? No. They flipped on us and they caved in. And they kept doing it over and over again. And we had to sit here, us Americans had to sit here and watch this happen. I don't know about y'all, but I felt like I was helpless. I'm watching my own government just spend as much money as they possibly could. This has got to stop. I mean, their spending habits are terrible. And we have no say in this. So I don't know. We can't spend this much money in the future. This is ridiculous.
Thank you. Mr. Spiegel.
Thank you, sir. First and foremost, protect everyone who has put into the system. We have made an agreement, a contract with, that you put this money in, it was going to be there. You make sure that they're protected. I do agree with others that what we need to do is to make sure that in the future, those who are not yet on the program, we can extend it out. It used to be, how long are you going to live? There was a life expectancy tied to it. But the great health care that we used to have, we no longer have, extended people's lives. And so maybe there should be an extension as to when you're able to then, if you can work into your 80s and you're spry and, you know, ready to go, you know, your life expectancy is probably a little later. So we should, for the future generations, do that. Get the people on off of it who are here illegally, who should not be on the system. Privatize, allow the privatization of some of it. Allow capitalism to take place with some of the investments. If I do a good job, I'm a good businessman, and I got money, I ought to be able to invest that money and be able to do so with part of my Social Security and stop the paternalistic attitude that the government knows best and how it can deal with our futures. Let us do it ourselves.
Thank you, and Mr. Jackson.
Okay. Well, with Medicare and Social Security, right now, 49 cents of every dollar is put towards Social Security and Medicare. 51% of the workforce has no private pension coverage. 34% of the workforce has no savings set aside specifically for retirement. Right now, the workforce, 2.8 workers are working now for every Social Security beneficiary. In 2035, it'll be down to 2.1 workers. So we need to find a way to find adjustments to what we're doing and revamp the Social Security and Medicare. In regards to Medicare and Social Security, look, I don't want to take anything away from the elderly. I don't want to take nothing from the individuals that have already paid in Social Security. So we need to support them because they've already paid. But with the young adults, we need to provide them some source to take their money and put it to privatization towards working on their own retirement and not using the government as a form of hopefully having a retirement 20, 30, 40 years down the road. And as for Medicare, we need to have an open free market for them, for people to start looking at a cheaper way of doing it and not relying on the government.
Thank you.
If I may take just a minute, to audience members that have questions, we appreciate your submissions. In just a short while, we'll have someone come along and collect some cards from you. Toward the end of the debate, we'll be asking those questions submitted by you. So I appreciate you submitting them, and we'll be right with you on those questions. One final question regarding the budget. We understand these are very broad questions and you don't have the time to answer them sufficiently because some of them have very complicated solutions. So we just want some general ideas from you to start. This is on tax reform. America needs tax reform because the current tax code stifles economic freedom, preventing the economy from being vibrant and prosperous. Tax rates for families, individuals, businesses, and investors are too high, discouraging work, savings, investment, and entrepreneurial risk-taking, the building blocks for economic growth. Please explain the key components of your recommended tax plan. Key components. Start with Mr. Goff, please.
Well, I think a flat tax would be pretty good, but we got to be careful on how we tax and the way we tax. We can't tax things over and over and over again. We can't keep taxing the same thing five and six times over. I think the government knows how to tax us, that's for sure. And The flat tax, to me, it sounds like a pretty good idea, but I would like to do a little bit more study on how they're going to tax and what they're going to tax. And is it a general tax overall, you know, on a total income? Are we going to be taxed on things that we've paid taxes on in the past? I mean, I believe that if you pay taxes on one thing, it shouldn't be taxed over and over again. You know, the government can get out of control with our taxes, and we all know that. So we got to be careful on how we tax. Thank you.
Thank you. Mr. Smigel.
Thank you very much. I also agree that there should be a flat tax. I would reduce the incentives for corporations to go overseas. We have the highest tax brackets in the world currently on our corporations. Give them an incentive to come back here. Give tax credits to going in and exploring and producing our energy here in the United States. Get those people up and working, get the pipeline running, get people using coal again. So give them the tax incentives to get the business up and running, put the flat tax in, and I also would encourage, through the use of the tax system, more savings. It allows the corporations also to reinvest in tooling up and getting things going with them. So I do like the flat tax idea. With the fair tax, there's some questions as to whether or not there is an encouragement on savings with that. I'd like to see whether or not the fair tax actually does or does not. And there's been both sides of that issue people were on. So I do know that I like the flat tax. Thank you.
Thank you. Mr. Jackson.
I too agree with both candidates there with the fair flat tax. I would like to see in regards to our income tax at about a 14%, business at 16%, because the corporate tax right now is at 39%, and that's far too great. A lot of corporations are taking their businesses overseas. What we need to do is reduce the corporate tax down to a 16% business tax, entice them to stay here in the United States. Give them all the breaks that they can to get the jobs here. And when you take countries like China that are having different items that they're making that are competing with the U.S. Businesses, what we need to do is tariff them significantly for the product they're trying to bring in here to the country, so that we make it more lucrative for the companies to stay here and make the products in here in the United States, therefore building a higher tax base because we have more jobs and we can work off of that rather than taxing everybody at a higher rate. Thank you.
Thank you. Mr. Harris.
Thank you. It's appropriate we're talking about taxes on April 14th, huh? As a matter of fact, today we had a press conference. I'm one of the co-sponsors of a bill that actually sunsets the entire IRS code in December 2019. And by passing it now, what you do is you'd give Congress 2.5 years, because Congress only works when you have a deadline, believe me, been there long enough to know that they would decide by December 2019 what they're going to do. Look, I'm a co-sponsor of the fair tax. I think a fair tax is one way to go. The fair tax, I think a flat tax could work as well. I was a co-sponsor of the estate tax repeal that we successfully passed through the House. I believe we, as you have heard up here, we have to decrease our corporate income tax in order to remain competitive. Very important for the Eastern Shore of Maryland, by the way, because, you know, we have two burdens. We have not only the federal tax burden, but we have a state tax burden. Fortunately, Larry Hogan's going to do something about it, I hope, that actually will not, so that we bring and encourage businesses to either locate or stay here, and for them to come and locate in Maryland. The last thing is that famous Cromnibus bill you hear so much about in 2014, maybe the reason why Nancy Pelosi voted against it, is it included a $350 million cut to the IRS, not the favorite government bureaucracy. Thank you.
So moving on to the economy and jobs, the National Bureau of Economic Research declared the recession officially ended in mid-2009, but middle-class individuals and families still are not feeling that recovery. Job creation rates still remain 10% below pre-recession levels. The unemployment rate has fallen, but this has primarily happened because many Americans have stopped looking for work. We know the 2009 stimulus failed to boost employment, and additional fiscal stimulus will not succeed either. Your question: please describe your plan for how the federal government should strengthen the middle class, grow the economy, and produce job creation. And we'll begin with Mr. Smigel.
Well, I think actually I just went through a good part of that. And what you do is you use the tax code to give incentives for that. Open up the energy fields here in the United States so that we can start selling coal abroad. They're going to get it elsewhere. Start letting us drill in Western Maryland and go out there and do the fracking. Let us put the people to work in those industries. Stop bringing people in on H-2B visas that come in here, 266,000 of them, so that they can take jobs supposedly we don't want, but they're truck driving jobs at $60,000 to $80,000 a year on the Eastern Shore. Why would we possibly be bringing people into this country on visas, quadrupling the visa quota, and then saying that we care about the jobs here on the Eastern Shore? You don't induce that and then say, yes, I'm out there helping you. So I'd stop that, give the incentives, drill for the oil, and give the tax incentives. Thank you very much.
Mr. Jackson.
Well, the first thing in regards to having more of a stimulus to our system, again, it comes back to Obamacare. Obamacare is destroying the small businesses. We need to get rid of that to allow the companies not to be held down and not able to expand as a result of the penalties that come along with failing to provide insurance for their employees. The fair flat tax, again, is for businesses, would be great. Free market, you got to allow companies to grow and fail. We can't have the government constantly bailing out big industry. We got to allow companies to grow and fail, and if they fail, well, then other companies will envelop and they will grow to take those spots. Which H-2B visas, again, we have plenty of people on welfare, and I know it might be underneath their feelings and take on arduous jobs, but we got to offer those jobs to our welfare recipients first, and then we can worry about the H-2B visa individuals afterwards. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Harris.
Thank you. Look, I just don't buy into the president's idea that the new normal of 2% GDP growth is all we can expect out of this economy. Fact of the matter is, since World War II, average GDP growth has been between 3.5% and 4%, except for the last 10 years, when it's been 2%. And the president brags about the economy having recovered. Nonsense. Nobody believes it. Nobody feels it. We're smarter than the president on this one, believe me. Regulations destroy business. We have to deal with the federal bureaucracy that all it's become is a regulation-generating business of its own, destroying American businesses. Last year, for the first time, more small businesses were destroyed in America than created. First time ever. We've got to realize that without small businesses, which are the core of our economy, you're not going to have that 3%, 4% economic growth. Let me deal with H-2B visas very quickly. Because this idea that if you just eliminate H-2B visa workers, somehow magically American workers will appear and do the job is just not true. In fact, the American Enterprise Institute, which is a conservative group, found that adding 100 H-2B workers results in an additional 464 jobs in the American economy. You know, that lady who comes in from Central America picking crab means that it's put on a truck driven by an American, goes to a grocery store with American clerks and laborers, or in a restaurant owned by an American. Thank you.
Thank you. And Mr. Goff.
Okay, for one, these guys are talking about H-2B visas. H-2B visas is farm worker help. Now, the H-1B visa is the higher education, master's degree, bachelor's degree jobs. In the past 6 years, 510,000 H-1B visas have been handed out to foreigners. And when I asked Andy about this, he said that his defense contractor buddies, they couldn't find enough qualified Americans to fill these positions. Well, I strongly disagree. I think that we have enough young people coming out of our colleges that are fully qualified to work these American jobs. It's ridiculous. Our government's giving away our jobs to foreigners. They don't even have green cards, for goodness sakes. This has got to stop. We got to take care of Americans first. And that's the way I'm going to handle things. We're going to take care of us American people first, American citizens first, our American companies first. Thank you.
I I guess I got mentioned again. I'm not surprising. I do want to just make a correction. H-2Bs are not agricultural visas. Those are H-2A visas. So we have to get the nomenclature right, because I'm talking about very specific visa, H-2Bs. Seafood processors, tourism industry, canning plant, the Friel canning plant right down the road that does vegetable canning. Very important. I don't have defense contractor buddies. I'm not sure who, you know, I'm a doctor. I don't have defense contractor buddies. I have physician buddies, but not defense contractor buddies. The fact of the matter is, whether it's an H-1B visa or an H-2B visa, they have to be advertised in the United States offering the prevailing wage for a period of time, and only if an American worker doesn't take it can they be offered to a foreign worker. And they are temporary in the case of H-2B. They can be dialed up and down. Very important for our economy. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you. The next question, very near and dear to people in this community, is on education. Over the past 6 years, the Obama administration has used a combination of carrots and sticks to prod states to adopt the Common Core State Standards Initiative. The effort to nationalize standards and tests represents one of the most significant federal overreaches into education in history and poses a grave threat to educational freedom in American schools. As a federal policymaker, how would you work to ensure that states are free to pursue education reforms that are in the best interest of local children and families? Start with Mr. Jackson, please.
Well, it comes down to states' rights. The government should not be dictating a national policy on education for all states to comply with. Every state's a little bit different based on their economics, based on where the children's upbringings from different areas of the country. There's a whole multitude of reasons why the federal government should not be there. In fact, one of the biggest things we should do is eliminate the Department of Education, allow each state to regulate their own school systems, and that would be a huge savings economically for the government. When it comes to Common Core, again, I'm totally against it. I think we have some of the best educators here in Maryland that could dictate a great policy that other states would want to emulate rather than wait for the government to dictate how they need to do things. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Harris.
Thanks. No, I think you're going to get broad agreement up here. I think probably all four of us are going to agree one thing you ought to do is just eliminate the Federal Department of Education. You don't need it. Those Pell Grants, you know, their claim is, well, you eliminate Pell Grants. Nonsense. Give it to the Department of Treasury. All it is a check from the Treasury. You don't need a whole department to run that. So first, eliminate the Department of Education. Second of all, de-link any linkage between federal funds, the carrot, and Common Core. And that's what we did in the Appropriations Committee, and then they did it pretty completely in the final education bill, although not completely enough for me to vote for that, for the education reauthorization. But you need to, because this is what happens. This is what the federal government does all the time. It gets the states hooked on the money, and then the mandates follow. And in the case of these mandates, they're expensive mandates, and in the case of Common Core, nobody in that Department of Education building in Washington knows better how to educate a student and what a student needs in Queen Anne's County than the teachers, parents, and Board of Education in Queen Anne's County. That's the way it ought to be. Thank you.
Thank you. Mr. Goff, please.
Well, I'm against the Common Core. That's for sure. And I think the Department of Education should be eliminated. I don't think government should be telling our children what they should learn and how they should learn. The educational process today is just horrible. We spend more money in the United States for education than most countries out there. But yet, we're ranked, what, number 36 on the level of our children in the world? It's not working. So I'm for, you know, private industry. The private programs for our children, you know, is much better than the government's program, because the government's just not working for us and our children. Our children don't even learn about the history these days. My goodness gracious, they've been forgotten. So this has got to stop. I mean, you know, we can do a much better job with this education. Thank you.
Thank you. Mr. Smigel.
In Maryland, when they wanted to adopt the Common Core. I put the bill in to repeal it after they did it. I stood on the floor and they said, well, we got $230 million that's coming from the feds. What strings are attached to it? I said, forget the money. We don't need that. And we voted against it and said that. The hubris of Congress to now say that we're going to have this extortion out there where you have to take all that comes with Common Core if you want to get your money. And now, what happened? They just passed H.R. 5, the Student Success Act. What did it do? It reauthorized the No Child Left Behind. They just did it to us again. They just went ahead again and passed this. The bill that the congressman should be putting in is to getting rid of the Board of Education. Don't sit here and tell us we want to get rid of the federal board unless you're actually going to do that. And so the Congress goes in there and tells us, elect us, send us into the Senate, send us into the House, we're going to go and do these things. And they don't do it. Why? Thank you.
I think you said the congressman in there.
No, I did not say the congressman. I said the Congress and the Senate. I was very careful.
Okay.
Thank
we'll have
you.
We'll have opportunities for closing statements as well. So, all right, gentlemen, your next question. And we'll begin with Mr. Harris. What are your ideas on expanding school choice to give educational control back to the families and local communities?
Thanks. It's a great question. It's one of the things I have a passion about. I had a passion about it when I sat on the Education Committee of the Maryland State Senate and brought that to Washington. You know, John Boehner gets a lot of criticism, but one thing he did that most people don't realize is he created the Opportunity Scholarship Program in the District of Columbia. And that's a school voucher program that takes students in failing schools and gives their parents the opportunity to enter a lottery for a limited number of vouchers to take their children where they think the education is best. So I've supported that. I've supported that both in the committee. I've supported that on the floor of the House. It came up in the very first continuing resolution that we passed, which Mr. Boehner kept that in. And on his last day at the last conference, I went up to him and thanked him for that. Just thanked him for being a leader on that. One disappointment is I asked him, who's going to be the leader now? You're leaving. Who's going to be the leader? He said, I don't know. I said, listen, anything I can do, you tell me. Because that's what we have to do as Republicans. We are languishing on education. We go into the inner cities, and that's the hope that we provide to those parents who want the best for their children, and that public school, public teacher union-dominated education system is failing them. So I believe we should look to things like the Opportunity Scholarship Program and expand them nationwide.
Thank you. Mr. Goff.
I think it should be tax deductible. If you want to have your child go to a private school, then it should be deducted off your taxes. You should have your own choice of where your child goes to school at. And what I mentioned before is we have all of these illegals coming into the United States, and what they're not mentioning is now they want to give them free education. Are they doing this for this? Are us Americans? No. Like I said, this has got to stop. We got to take care of Americans first. Our education is a mess. So I am for tax deducted. If you send your child to a private school, then it should be off of your taxes, and you shouldn't have to deduct that from your taxes, and you should pay for that out of your own pocket, but we shouldn't be paying taxes for other kids to be learning Common Core. Thank you.
Thank you. Mr. Smigel.
Thanks, sir. When I was in the Maryland legislature, I put in a bill to take the power away from the State Department of Education and give it to each of the local boards of education. It didn't go there, but that's the same thing I would do in Congress, is take the power, put it local. They know best. I have supported vouchers. I put in bills to support homeschoolers. So I'm very much in support of alternatives to the current educational system. I'm almost 60 years old. Think about this. We got to the moon on phonics. I mean, why do we need Common Core and all of these new methods where I got teachers coming to me telling I'm quitting because I can't put up with what they're asking me to do to the children. She tells me she has children that are all upset with what they're being asked to do. We don't need to have the federal government paternalistically coming in and saying, you accept this money, you take these strings attached. I would fight very hard, like I did in the Maryland legislature, to return the power locally, let the locals decide what they want to do with the education, and let them have alternative to public schools. Thank you.
Thank you. Now, Mr. Jackson.
Okay. Again, we're $19 trillion in debt.
I'm against the vouchers, and the reason is we don't have the money to keep handing out to everyone for special rights or special needs of individuals. We have to look at the money and spend it. We have to scrutinize our spending. Basically, the money that we spend has to go towards public schools for the greatest good for the greatest number. In regards to the working class, how many individuals here would love to pull their kids maybe out of public school and put them in a religious school or a private school? In Cecil County, initially when I lived in Perryville, I wanted to pull my kids out, but it was going to cost me $12,000 to put them in a local religious middle school. Couldn't afford it. But then there's other individuals that say, hey, I want to send my kid to a private school because I don't like the public school, and we give them a voucher and we pay thousands of dollars for it. My thing is this, you give them a little bit of the money that they would pay their percentage into tax, and that's a percentage you give back and say, take that money that you would have gave to the local community, and now you take your child elsewhere, but you're not getting an extra penny more. That's where I stand on it. Thank you.
At this point in the program, I'd like to ask my fellow committee members to collect whatever cards the audience may have with questions, if you don't mind. We're going to abridge some of these questions so we can make sure we get to the audience members' questions. If you have any questions about the abridged version, please ask us. We'll be happy to fill in the blanks. Energy, quick question on energy. How do we break through the stalemate in Washington to win the argument for energy development and U.S. energy independence? Starting with Mr. Goff, please.
The latest geological survey says that America has over $50 trillion of gas and oil in our country. Mm-hmm. Now, the one thing, we should be energy independent. I'm tired of relying on Saudi Arabia telling us how much our oil prices and our gas prices are. Whenever they feel like it. They fluctuate, you know, on the supply and demand just to make themselves a fat cat. I'm sorry, but they're just getting rich off of us. And we've been their policemen, guarding their country and their army and their military. They should be paying us back for all of, they should be paying down our debt because we've spent so much money on their country, just policing their country from Iran. Now, as far as being energy independent, now, we own the lease agreements for Exxon, Shell, and all the other big energy companies in America. We should be telling them what to charge us, and we should be regulating them on how much they're charging Americans for our gasoline products. Thank you.
Thank you. Mr. Smigel.
Thank you. With respect to energy, I won't go over everything that I've already discussed about opening up the energy fields, but I would ask that as Republicans, we'd be smart. Let's think about, we have a hydroelectric dam at the head of our bay, and that hydroelectric dam wants to do a renewal of a contract. Should we not say, if you want to generate electric, that you don't endanger the billions of dollars that we have put in cleaning that bay by saying we're not going to make you go and clean that up, that we're going to take MDE out of the mix and not let them be able to say, you know what, the water quality coming down the Susquehanna, which if you saw today is the third dirtiest river in the country, should not be polluting our bay, killing our crabbing industry, killing the industry we have here for our local watermen and such. So let's be smart about the energy and say, we're going to, if you want to renew that contract, clean up those catches behind it. Get rid of the phosphates, the sediments, and the nitrogen that's going to come up in a plume that goes 100 miles down to the mouth of the Potomac. We don't want to waste those billions of dollars we've invested. Thank you.
Thank you. Mr. Jackson.
Okay. When it comes to the oil, I do support the Keystone Pipeline. I support exporting oil. As Mr. Goff has said, we are protecting Saudi Arabia and a lot of Middle Eastern countries to allow them to make billions and billions of dollars every year, and yet they stick it to us consistently with high prices and fluctuation of prices that keeps us on edge. I do support innovative energy ideas. at a private, with your private residence and stuff like that. But when they try to go green or initiatives or alternative initiatives that are not cost effective, like putting 1,000 windmills off the coast of Maryland, that's going to cost us billions of dollars. It doesn't even make sense why we would do that. So I don't support those type of businesses that are going to the money's going to come out of our pockets, especially when you see these type of businesses that don't reciprocate or give us money back by having reduced costs on our billing. They take the money and the subsidies from the government, but at the same time, they go ahead and give us high prices. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Harris.
You know, for all intents and purposes, we have North American energy independence now. I mean, we generate enough fossil fuel product in North America between coal and oil and natural gas to be energy independent when you count Canada and Mexico. So we're well on the road to that. But what we have to do, and you've heard this here, it's a bad idea to pick winners and losers, to subsidize some types of energy, not other types of energy. But I will tell you, I was a little concerned because I think you heard, you know, about price controlling. Somehow that if we tell Exxon, by the way, Exxon is the largest oil company in the world, largest privately owned oil company in the world. We should be actually proud that it's in the United States. We should do everything we can to keep it in the United States. But when you say that, in some way imply that you're going to tell it what price to charge for its product when oil is an absolutely global commodity, you will chase them out of the United States in a New York minute. There's no question about it. Look, I couldn't agree more about Conowingo. We should never cut the state out of the ability to license with FERC. And look, that's the way it ought to be. It's set up properly. The system is set up properly where MDE gets the first crack and then FERC gets the second crack. Thank you.
I think I was mentioned.
Thank you.
Was I mentioned in that last comment? No?
I don't think so.
Just insulted, not mentioned.
Oh, okay.
Moving on to health care. The Patient Protection and Affordable Care Act, Obamacare, fails to address the fundamental problems with the American health care and indeed makes many problems worse. Making the assumption that you agree and that you are not in support of Obamacare, gentlemen, do you support the reform or the total repeal of Obamacare? And the second part is, with what would you replace it? And we'll begin with Mr. Smigel.
Well, this is going to be better, because when I got this same question a couple nights ago, I got booed when I said Obamacare has destroyed the finest health system in the world. All the liberals at the League of Women Voters booed me. So I believe that I would totally replace it. And the way we have health savings accounts, Maryland puts a $6,100 limit on what you can do with those, raise that. The question is, what do you do with pre-existing conditions? Well, you make them portable. You make it so that you can take your insurance from where you go. And one of the ways is break down those borders that are artificially put in there, which if you got a really great system that's out there in Texas and you want to buy that, you can't buy it. You have to buy from a Maryland company. So take down the borders between the states, let the free enterprise system work, let the people go in there and say, we're going to give you a better health system. And so it can work. We had the finest system in the world. We could put that back in place and address. You don't help by saying 9 million more people got insurance when 200 million got worse insurance and it's more expensive and it was the highest tax increase in history. And you shouldn't vote for that. Thank you.
And Mr. Jackson.
Okay. I'm against a total repeal of Obamacare, 100%. I don't think we should be jumping in there and signing off on provisions and allowing it to sustain. It needs to go away. Again, as I said numerous times over this evening, that it's destroying small businesses. We definitely need a health savings plan where people and families can pay into a health savings plan and put money away and not lock it down on an individual person. Allow immediate family members to use it. So if someone does become sick or comes down with a major issue, health concern, or major health issue, they can draw from it as a pot, and it can be actually turned over to family upon your death. But we do need to have an open competitive market. Again, no boundaries where it's state to state. It's either national or regionalized, but definitely don't want to put boundaries and limit where an individual can get health insurance, because you want to have a market that's competitive, that reduces costs, and makes it affordable for everyone. Thank you.
Thank you. Mr. Harris, please.
Yeah, you're absolutely right. Look, when I got elected again to fire Pelosi, the hue and cry in the country was this incredible Affordable Care Act shoved down America's throats. So we had over 50 opportunities to vote to restrict or repeal the bill. And that's exactly what I did. Went down there and voted against them. The last time, the reconciliation bill we put on the president's desk. President veto. Look, you need a new president. That's the bottom line. But people say, well, there's no Republican alternative. Nonsense. Liberal media says that because they're too lazy to go up and look up H.R. 2653, which is the Republican Study Committee bill I co-sponsored and co-authored, that is a comprehensive, deals comprehensively with not only with reforming health care insurance, but actually health care research, the liability, medical liability issues. It's a more comprehensive approach than even the president took, and it'll be far more affordable. So again, go look up H.R. 2653. Those of you who have liberal friends who say, oh, but there's no alternative, H.R. 2653, have them look it up. Thank you.
Thank you. Mr. Goff.
Well, look at H.R. 3547, and you'll see which one of our congressmen, about 166 Republican congressmen, voted to fund Obamacare, when at that crucial moment, in 2014, September 15th, 2014, they voted to fund Obamacare, and they kept it alive. Obamacare, the premiums are rising, the quality of service is getting worse, it's a job killer, we're losing our doctors. The state of Maryland's put a cap on how much they're going to be giving our hospitals, so we are going to get worse care. I want to get rid of Obamacare, and that's it. And I think that our capitalism should work for itself. I think we should be able to buy health insurance like we get our car insurance. And that way we get the best pick of what plan fits our families the best. And believe me, they're going to be fighting for our business. Open up the borders is what they should have done the last time. Open up the borders for the insurance companies. And that was half the problem. So that's my answer to that one. So I think if you look into that, it'll work. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Smigel.
I think I started, sir.
Oh, I'm sorry. You did.
Like judiciary, change the rules.
Go ahead.
We do want to take some time to ask some questions for those in the audience and in our community that are involved in the agricultural industry. U.S. agricultural policy is outdated and has not changed to keep up with modern farming and ignores free market principles that once promoted prosperity for farming families and an ample food supply for this nation. In addition, environmental regulation, trade barriers, and infringements of property rights create unnecessary and costly obstacles for farmers. Congress should create agricultural policy that benefits all Americans, from the farmers who produce the food to the consumers who purchase it. If elected to Congress, how would you reform agricultural policy, and how would you rein in bloated federal agencies like the U.S. Department of Agriculture and the Environmental Protection Agency? Starting with Mr. Jackson, please.
Okay. Well, here in Maryland, I feel our farmers are doing a great job in regards to trying to keep phosphates and all the pollutants in the water. But when we have overregulation by the Department of Agriculture and EPA, that's what causes these individuals to lose money, and ultimately, if they can't sustain to stay here in Maryland, they're going to move away and go to other states. It's very important to protect the farmers, to protect their way of life. Again, they provide businesses. Their businesses provides for jobs and job growth, but ultimately, we need to probably reduce and rein back the EPA at the federal level to save on the federal money and having big government. How many different governments do we need, or how many forms of governments do we need to regulate one industry, which is the farmers? So protecting them and keeping them here in Maryland is utmost importance. Thank you.
Thank you. Mr. Harris, please.
You know, it's strange to say, but actually the U.S. Department of Agriculture is actually one of the better departments in Washington. And I'm not sure exactly why that is. I sit on the Agriculture Subcommittee, so, you know, we have them come testify all the time. But it's generally run by farmers, and it actually does a pretty good job. So of the two, USDA or EPA, the target, the one that puts the target on the farmer's back is the EPA. There's no question about it. The Environmental Protection Agency, and one of the reasons, one of the big accomplishments, actually, of the Republicans in the last 6 years is we have brought the EPA funding levels back to pre-Pelosi levels. We literally have taken it back. In fact, we've taken it back to 1998 levels for the EPA. That's where they ought to be. Those issues are best left up to the state. Nobody cares about the water quality in Maryland more than Maryland cares about the water quality in Maryland. With regards to helping the agriculture industry in the 1st Congressional District, it's helping the poultry industry. That's why the poultry industry supports me, because they know I go to bat for them each and every time they have an issue with their federal regulators, whether it's the USDA or the EPA. Thank you.
Thank you. Mr. Goff.
The Environmental Protection Agency is taking the stamp off of our American products. So now when you go out there and buy fish and you buy chicken, we don't know where it's coming from. Could be coming from China. So we got to put that stamp back on there. And this is going to help our American farmers. The other thing I don't want to see is and I'm hearing a lot of stories about this, that outside countries are coming into the United States and buying up our farms. I don't want that to happen, okay? Now, as far as the rainwater runoff, we have a farmer right here sitting amongst us, Sam Owings. Stand up, Sam. Show everybody who you are. Now, Sam has been doing an environmental impact study for the past 6 years. And he's got a fantastic plan, and I put it on Governor Hogan's desk. So if you all want to go to his impact study plan, you ought to check it out. It's very interesting, and it's a good plan. Thank you.
Thank you. I also want to say I've been to Sam's farm several times and seen the system, too, and it's an excellent system, and I thank you for having me out there, Sam. The federal government has no right being involved in agricultural business, unless it's dealing with interstate transport of some kind, but there's no reason that the federal government should be involved. Let the states decide how they're going to take care of the crops, take care of the farmers, and what they want to do. I've been to Sam's and I already did that. I apologize. The Oysterman Association, when the Oystermen came to me and they said, Mike, we got a real problem, what's going on down in the legislature, and they, you know, can we use a bill? I said, wait a minute, why don't we start your own Oysterman's Association? You don't need to go down there and have me put a bill in when we can start an association and you can be part of that process. And now it's one of the largest organizations that's out there. So I didn't say the big hand of government has to get involved. I showed them how they could take care of it themselves and then be able to be involved in what's going on a continuing basis. So I helped start the Watermen's Association so that they could, the Oysterman's Association, so that they could be involved in resolving that. Big government doesn't have to be paternalistic and tell you what to do. Thank you.
Mr. Jackson, did you answer on this question?
Yes, I did. I was the one that started it.
Okay. I have a follow-up question from an audience member on civil asset forfeiture, or the kingpin law. It says, has evolved into the systematic shakedown of law-abiding citizens by various government law enforcement agencies confiscating money and other valuables without due process, guilty until proven innocent. Mm. U.S. farmers and businesses are unjustly targeted with government seizing bank accounts, taking citizens years with costly legal fees to prove their innocence, and then never getting the full amount of the money returned. This is not the question that I... Yep. Okay, this is an unrelated question. What would you do as a congressman to change or eliminate this law? Mr. Jackson, I believe you're up.
Sorry. Was he up first?
Mr. Harris.
It's what I did. I co-sponsored the bill that eliminated the ability for civil asset forfeiture for someone who's dealing. You know, the problem was, you know, it was a roadside farmer in Talbot County. who accumulated cash, took it to the bank, was actually told by the bank, gee, don't make a $10,000 cash deposit because you got to report it to the federal government otherwise. So they went ahead and didn't do that. Federal government came in, seized over $45,000 of their bank account. So I put in the bill that said, you can't do that. We wrote language in the appropriations bill, said you can't do that, and guess what? They changed their policy so where they're not going to do that. Now, why it literally took a threat of an act of Congress is beyond me, but that's why I guess Donald Trump is leading in the polls. Thank you.
Thank you. Mr. Goff.
If I get in there, it's not going to happen. We'll stop the government from coming in and forfeiting your property, that's for sure. And when I heard this, when I first heard that was going on, how would you like somebody to come into your house, take your property, take your land, kick you out of there, close out your bank account, and then you got to go get representation because of something that they thought was wrong, and you have to prove yourself innocent? Seems to me like you're guilty until proven innocent. That's got to stop. That's not going to happen if I get into Congress, that's for sure. Thank you.
Mr. Smeagol.
I spent 10 years in the Maryland House Delegates on the Judiciary Committee, and I led the fight against civil asset forfeitures. There's a video out, you'll see out now. They're producing a movie about the civil asset forfeiture. I'm in that talking about some of the problems with that. It absolutely has to stop. It violates the Constitution. You do not take somebody's property before they have had due process and had a trial. I'll give you a perfect example. It's more profitable to go down and get cigarettes in Virginia or North Carolina and drive them up to New York than it is to run drugs now. I get a man who's driving through the state. He's not stopping in Maryland. He has a license to sell them in New Jersey and a license to sell them in Ohio. He has two licenses. You don't know that he's not going to pay whatever tax is responsible in those other states, but the state of Maryland stops him, takes all the cigarettes, takes the van, and makes him then go out and hire a lawyer to try to get them back. Absolutely what we don't want from our government. We want our government to be standing with us, holding a shield with its back to us, not facing us, holding a sword.
Mm-hmm. Thank you. Mr. Jackson.
And I agree with all three candidates on that. Again, we have to have the 14th Amendment, a right for due process. We have to allow the courts to make that decision. If it's a case, Mr. Smeagol had mentioned in regards to cigarettes, untaxed, they can easily photograph it, determine what evidentiary value they need, and they can go ahead through the proper proceedings rather than taking their van, taking their vehicle, taking the products that they bought legally in one state that they're transporting to another, that our state, and O'Malley was famous for that one. If they buy a pack of cigarettes or an abundant amount in Virginia and it's taxed there and stamped, and they're going to take it up to New York to make a significant profit, how does Maryland have a tax loss there? I've never understood it, but that was a process that law enforcement was all involved in, that we would take their vehicle and all their products and consider it tax evasion or tax, some form of a tax fraud. So I agree with all the three individuals that, yeah, you have to have due process. Thank you.
We all get to go now.
I think the exception to the rebuttal rule is when you've been mentioned in an agreement. Leave well enough alone, I guess. We do have a question for Mr. Harris, and it is from the audience based on the fact that you were the only of the panelists who have a record, and it was a specific question, and it is as follows. Our farming families across the district have been made to jump through one political hoop after the other to satisfy state and federal mandates imposed in the name of environment and health of the Chesapeake Bay. While state legislators have taken action by joining the Clean Chesapeake Coalition, you have gone in another direction, voting in favor of the Hydropower Improvement Act of 2015, which effectively strips the state of its authority to hold hydropower dam owners like Exelon, the owner of the Conowingo Dam, accountable for water quality violations. So, Mr. Harris, what do you say to the farmers who feel like they are bearing most of the burden for the Bay health?
Sure. Look, my record with the farm industry is clear. You ask anybody from the Farm Bureau. They know that I'm a friend of the farmer. I would urge whoever wrote the question to go back and look up H.R. 8 and go back and look exactly at what it did. It did not cut the state out. I'll read you right here from a statement. This is from the committee that reported the bill out. They said under the bill what the bill does is merely change the timeline by requiring state approval if a state is extending review past the one-year deadline. Now, a state gets one year to comment on it. Now, those of you in business, how many times do your businesses get one year to make a decision? All this says state gets one year. After that, it has to go to a court. If you want to stop it, it goes to a court. Or the state could deny it and start the permitting process all over. This did not remove the state. What this bill did is provide electric grid security. That's what the bill was mainly about, where it allowed, for instance, electric suppliers to stockpile transformers, which in the case of an EMP would be destroyed, and our larger transformers actually have to be imported from other countries. This bill actually allowed them to stockpile it. So the main purpose of the bill was actually electric grid security.
Thank you.
This involves a couple of the audience members' questions. We're going to try to incorporate them regarding illegal immigration and border security. One of the federal government's core responsibilities is control of our borders and determine who enters the United States. Regrettably, the government has consistently failed at this, leading to today's untenable situation with over 11 million individuals unlawfully present in the U.S. and competing for American jobs and resources. Rather than enforce the law fairly and equally, the Obama administration has worked to turn U.S. immigration laws on their head, going so far as taking executive action to provide protection from deportation, pseudo-legal status, and work authorization to as many as 5 million illegal immigrants. What is your position on amnesty? Please include in your answer whether you support a path to citizenship for immigrants already here illegally, and the audience member is interested in build a wall or not build a wall? Starting with Mr. Goff, please.
Build a wall. And what part of illegal do they not understand? We have immigration laws. Enforce them. My wife came into the United States legally, the right way, waited in line, no attorneys. Didn't take that long. We paid the fees. But they made her get a health examination, a police report. We have a file about this thick, just to make sure that she was fine from any AIDS, hepatitis, tuberculosis, measles. And they don't do that with these illegals right now. What do you think's going on in our health system today? I'm hearing that we just got four more cases of H1N1 virus. In fact, we have a friend of ours, daughter, who's fighting for her life at St. Joe's right now from H1N1. She doesn't even know where she contracted that virus. So I am for a pathway to the United States, but wait in line like everybody else. And if you're here, I'm sorry. You have to go back to your country, and we have to secure our borders. Put the troops on our borders and secure our borders. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Smeagol.
There is a way for people to immigrate to this country, and it's the legal way. And you go through, you put in your visas, you come here, you learn the language, you learn the culture, you assimilate into the culture, and that is what we have set up as a process that has worked for hundreds of years, and then that's the way. You don't allow the President of the United States to usurp the authority of Congress by going outside the Constitution and say, I'm going to grant an amnesty. You don't stand there and then vote to allow that to take place. When an executive exceeds their authority, you stop them. When Martin O'Malley decided he was going to use his authority to say, outside the Constitution, I'm going to make every daycare provider in the state go join a union, I sued him as a legislator. I said, you don't have that authority. You got to stop that. There are things we could do. And as far as, yes, build the wall, what I would do for a wall is, somebody's been paying attention, is to put a military installation that tests the tanks here, 400 miles away. You're going to put one that maybe tests drones 400 miles down the road there in the desert. You're going to do one that tests helicopters, and you'll be able to get people employed, and you'll be able to protect our borders, because it's not just the illegals coming in. It's the other than Mexicans coming in from ISIS and elsewhere that are a danger. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Smeagol. Mr. Jackson.
Okay, definitely for building a wall.
Definitely, as a military, coming from the military, I think we should have our military personnel all along the border. They did that back in the late 80s, early 90s, when I was stationed out in California. They put military members along the borders down in Southern California and down in Southern Arizona. When it comes to the DREAM Act, I'm against it. How dare we even consider taking illegal aliens or anyone from outside our country and paying for their college when our college rates are through the roof, and yet we're going to take our money and put them through college and give them an opportunity? How about giving ourselves an opportunity first? That's absolutely ridiculous that would even be considered. They should not vote, they shouldn't have licenses, and they shouldn't have be recipients of our welfare and our health care systems. I'm against birthrights. Only 30 of 194 countries allow for it. We shouldn't. We shouldn't allow them to come on here if have mom and dad as illegal aliens, and just because they gave birthright, all of a sudden now we're going to pay for that child for the next 18 to 50 years. Thank you.
Thank you. Mr. Harris.
Sure. No, I'm quite clear on this. I've always said I oppose amnesty, and I oppose a pathway to citizenship. You cannot reward someone who commits an illegal act with one of the ultimate rewards in the world, which is citizenship in the United States. Imagine that. In what parallel universe do you reward someone for breaking your laws by giving them citizenship in the country? Look, we can build a wall. It can be actual. It can be virtual. The fact of the matter is the majority of people here illegally did not come over the border illegally. They came in on temporary visas and overstayed them. So until you have an administration that's willing to actually enforce the current temporary visas, you can build a wall 20,000 feet high. You got to enforce the temporary visas, and with biometrics we should be. Look, my record's clear. After summer of 2014, the president, an executive order, did DACA, which, you know, was allowed the children in. In 2014, I voted in favor of 5272, which defunded the program. 2014 voted the one that actually prohibited the executive branch from doing that. 2015 voted for the Blackburn Amendment. I co-sponsored Representative Gosar's bill disallowing tuition for illegal immigrants in college, and co-sponsored to repeal the birthright citizenship. My record's clear.
Prior to tonight, the campaigns were asked if they would like to direct a question from their campaign to another campaign. So we have two questions. The first is from Mr. Harris to Mr. Jackson. Do you worry that legalizing marijuana would be dangerous to our kids based on the Colorado experience? The question is for you, Mr. Jackson.
Well, I believe that marijuana, yes, it's dangerous to a point, but the U.S. government has patents on it, and in the Journal of Medicine out of New England, 76% of the doctors had said that we should legalize marijuana in a sense for medicinal purposes. 70% of people in AARP say that we should legalize marijuana, and when they say it's a gateway drug, basically, if you talk to anyone that's on a hardcore drug like heroin, methamphetamines, that are destroying lives and destroying society, we need to concentrate on that. Prohibition doesn't work. We legalized alcohol, but if you talk to those individuals that are on those drugs and they say it's a gateway drug, they've also tried cigarettes, which are legal. They've also tried alcohol, which is legal. So marijuana, again, is a drug that is far less dangerous than alcohol and the drugs and all the contaminants that are in the cigarettes. So yes, I am for legalizing marijuana.
Thank you. Mr. Harris, did you?
Yeah, I think by the rules, I guess I get to indicate why I asked the question. Look, the recent data on marijuana is actually very troubling. The marijuana people smoke now is not the marijuana that was 25, 30 years ago, 35 years ago, much more potent. And the fact of the matter is the scientific evidence shows that it actually permanently affects the hard wiring of the developing brain. So that if you have the evidence in Colorado where teenage use is the highest ever and it went up after the licensing of medical marijuana, you better think twice about legalizing. And I've asked Dr. Volkow this specific question, head of the National Institutes of Drug Abuse, the national expert on this. She says it's a gateway drug, and we ought to think very, very carefully about any attempts at legalization of this drug until we have the medical information that we need.
Thank you. The next question is from Mr. Smigel to Mr. Harris. Knowing that full funding for Obamacare, Obama's amnesty for illegal immigrants, and expanded federal funding for abortions were all part of the Crumbliness bill of 2014, you have stated you voted for the bill anyway because there was lots of, quote, good stuff for the first district. What exactly was the, quote, good stuff that justified such a vote?
Sure. Look, my record on Obamacare is pretty clear. I held up, don't believe me, go to the Congressional Research Service, look up my voting record. I voted over 50 times to repeal or replace either all or large parts of Obamacare because it's going to bankrupt our country. In fact, and look, the illegal immigration charge, I have an A career rating from Numbers USA, which, again, go to an objective source, one that rates it, I have an A rating in terms of that. We already dealt with the funding of abortion. I mean, I could read it again. I could read National Right to Life letter again. I'm not going to do that. Fact of the matter is the Cromnibus bill, I mean, Nancy Pelosi opposed it. So I guess if you wanted me to vote against it, you wanted me to vote with Nancy Pelosi. Why'd she oppose it? Three new pro-life provisions in the bill. We returned discretionary spending to pre-Pelosi levels. It continued the downward slope of spending. We had no new funding for Obamacare. And in fact, we had the Rubio Amendment, which was critical. It took $2.5 billion of taxpayer funds and refused to use them for the risk corridors, payoffs to large insurance companies under Obamacare. So we actually cut the funding for Obamacare. So those are the facts. Look it up.
Thank you.
And as for the rating, I got the higher rating. I got True Reformer. That's the highest rating they give on the numbers with respect to that. Also got 100% with the Farm Bureau and 100% with the National Federation of Independent Business and 100% with the Maryland Right to Life. And I'm the only member here or in the state has the A-plus from the National Rifle Association. It's the highest rating that they've got, and I got the Defender of Freedom Award for that. So as far as the issue with respect to the congressman's previous position, I'm sorry, I lost my train of thought there trying to address that. I have to go back for a minute and address an absolute false statement that was made here with respect to the marijuana. The veterans in this state and in this country were denied the ability for PTSD treatment to be able to even have their doctors suggest that they should have marijuana because the congressman voted against that even being allowed. So you got 24, 25 veterans a day killing themselves across this country, and the congressman steps in and says you can't. Marijuana is of a lower quality that's going to hurt you. They're able to now work the drug as agriculturally and produce it for specific effects. And it's absolutely wrong to take that paternalistic attitude toward those who served us. And you or I can walk in off the street and we can get that drug, but a veteran can't.
Mr. Harris?
A veteran absolutely can. Go back and read the state law. Look, the fact of the matter is, there's a reason why the National Right to Life Committee endorsed me. There's a reason why the NRA endorsed me. Because I'm a real conservative who went to Washington and did exactly what they said. A lot of people promise, and a lot of people have records in the state. I went to Washington and have a federal record, and it's protecting your gun rights, it's protecting the right to life, it's decreasing spending, and it's fighting against the president's illegal immigration policies. Those are the facts. Don't believe me, go to the people who watch federal voting records and see what they say. I'm proud of my record, I stand by it, and I'm putting it in front of you to ask you to reelect me to Congress.
Thank you. We received a related question from the audience, so I want to give this equal time. This is addressed to Mike Smigel. Mr. Smigel, it says, you mentioned funding for abortions, and the question is, did you not co-sponsor along with Heather Mazur, who was a Democrat in the state legislature, to fund Planned Parenthood-like organizations to, quote, avoid unwanted pregnancies, end quote?
Absolutely, and that's one of the most things I'm most proud of, because it stopped 2,600 abortions a year. What we did was take $40 million of government money that was already there from women who were pregnant and going to have a crack baby and be on an incubator and take care of her and move it to the front, give them prenatal care, get them off of the crack pipe, and we've reduced the infant mortality rate in this state by 23% in 3 years. There wasn't one thing that went to helping an abortion. We stopped 2,600 abortions. And that's the problem with the hypocrisy of Republicans. Read the bills. I got over 20,000 votes that I've taken in there, and I read the bills, and I would stand up when a bad bill came and say, you know what? I'm not voting for this, sir. I'm putting a yellow light up because I haven't had time to read the bill. You go down to Congress, you just vote on it, you come here, and you put out some bull that means nothing. I am very proud of that, and I saved 2,600 abortions a year by voting on that, and I reduced the infant mortality rate by 23%, standing on principle. I got 100% rating every year from the Maryland Right to Life. Don't you think that they would have thought something was wrong if that bill did something bad?
Thank you. I'm not sure that I read the question as the audience member intended, so I'm going to make an exception here to ask the audience member if they want to clarify how the question was asked.
Are we going to have an argument if he wants to bring him on up here? The former delegate can come up and I'll debate him.
Well,
this wasn't a reform of the question. It was an argument on it. So I answered my question. If he wants to come up, have him come on up and we'll debate.
Delegate Saucy, would you like to restate the question if I asked the question incorrectly?
The bottom line is, it's okay to fund abortions if we save money in the long run.
There was no funding of abortions, not one. That's a false statement. I just told you what it did. It stopped crack babies from having to be treated after they were born and gave mothers prenatal care. Not $1 went to crack babies. And if I did, don't you think the Maryland Right to Life would have said something about it? They gave me 100% rating.
I think Mr. Smeagol's response is clear on this question, so we're going to move on to the next question. Thank you.
Good try, Dick.
Another question from the audience, and we're going to direct this to everyone. What are your feelings regarding drug testing for welfare recipients? If I am subject to random drug testing as a working taxpaying citizen, then why shouldn't they? I would rather see tax dollars spent on getting testing process up and running in order to save money in the long run. So let's begin with Mr. Jackson.
Absolutely, 100%. If you can afford to use drugs, then you're off welfare, cut and dry. We're not going to pay a single penny. I don't know how else to say it.
Thank you. Mr. Harris.
Totally agree.
All right. Mr. Goff.
I totally agree as well.
And Mr. Smeagol.
Are we going to do it with cigarettes, alcohol, and all other things, since marijuana now in Maryland has legal uses, such as somebody has psoriasis and some other ways that they give it? I mean, I'm just trying to figure out what the question meant. Is it going to be just, I don't want people who are on welfare being able to spend money on drugs. Absolutely not.
Okay.
But I don't want to take somebody who has been given a medical use of it. It could be somebody, a veteran who has PTSD, who was able to use it, and then say, sorry, you can't have that, and make that choice. So
I think the question was framed around the illegal use.
Absolutely. Yeah. Absolutely. You don't get any federal, you don't get any funds at all.
Very good. Now we should maybe call for a moment of silence because of the agreement, unanimous agreement we have at the panel.
I'm a libertarian, and I got to be careful that I don't step on the Constitution.
Very good.
Okay, an additional audience member question. I believe we're starting with Mr. Harris. How do you feel about the Davis-Bacon Act, where we have the federal government decide what free enterprise will pay workers and put the bill on the back of the taxpayers?
Sure. No, the Davis-Bacon Act federal was the analogy of the prevailing wage in Maryland. I was a leader against prevailing wage in Maryland. All it does is raise the cost of every public thing we do. We could build 20% more highways if we repealed Davis-Bacon. You talk about infrastructure, you want to improve infrastructure, repeal Davis-Bacon. That's why I introduced the amendment on the floor. It was my amendment on the floor 3 years ago to one of the appropriations bills that actually was the Davis-Bacon amendment. It fails. We don't we don't have enough people who support free enterprise and right to work in Congress yet. But you know, if you send me back, you do have one from this district. Thank you.
Yeah, I want to repeal the Davis-Bacon Act. That's for sure. It just doesn't make any sense, and I have to agree with Congressman Harris on that. So that's how I feel about it. Repeal the Davis-Bacon Act.
Thank you. Mr. Smigel.
I, too, have to agree with the gentleman two seats down from me. Didn't want to say it. Didn't want to say his name.
And I
Mr.
agree
Jackson
also,
is
yes.
Unanimous.
Yes.
Thank you.
Thank you.
If I may elaborate on that, in Maryland, in the House of Delegates, I stood on the floor, pointed to the unions, and said Maryland should be a right-to-work state. They got very upset because when they passed the Fair Share Act, what they did was I had to explain to them, excuse me, when you got to be the exclusive bargaining position, that was so that you would take care of the people who didn't want to join your union. You can't come in now and say you're going to make the ones who don't want to join now have to pay. And so what we were able to do is say, well, then, if you don't want to join a union, you shouldn't have to. And they got all upset and booed me, but yes, I did say Maryland should be a right-to-work state and fought for that.
Very good, thank you. We have time for maybe one more question, and then we have closing statements. This question from the audience. With solar energy on the rise, what steps should be put into place to control future power supply rate increases, suppliers' rate increase? What steps should be put into place to control future power suppliers' rate increases? And we'll start with Mr. Goff.
Well, we have to regulate these power companies because you know as well as I do what happened to Marylanders a couple of years ago when we were getting $700 a month electric bills, when we had a governor in the past who deregulated the electric company, the Baltimore Gas and Electric, and look what happened. What did they do? They raised our electric rates, you know, like three or four times. I mean, they ruined Christmas for so many families across Maryland because they just jacked up the rates for no reason whatsoever. So I think that they need to be regulated by the state of Maryland. And the other thing is, everybody's talking about the Conowingo Dam. Well, what nobody's mentioning is all the power from the Conowingo Dam is going to New Jersey. But yet they want us to refurbish the Conowingo Dam with all the sediment that's built up there. I think that New Jersey should fork in some money and refurbish that dam because they haven't done nothing about fixing that dam in the past 30 years. Thank you.
And Mr. Smigel.
I'm for limiting regulation as much as possible for safety reasons. Obviously, we don't want somebody that says, I always want to start my own nuclear facility down the street. I'm a capitalist. I'm for free enterprise. I'm saying take down the impediments to business being able to be competitive, and that's the way to go, as opposed to over-regulating any business.
Thank you. And Mr. Jackson.
Okay. We definitely have to have a competitive market, allow other industry to or other corporations to come in to compete with like BG&E. One thing that our beautiful state of Maryland does is pay them for advertisement, different stuff like the smart meters and stuff like that. They actually paid them in subsidies in excess of well over $100 million. And yet they will use those type of advertisements to support their business, but in turn not reciprocate any type of deals or any type of benefits to our to people that use the electricity and stuff. So we need to stop subsidies to big corporations like that. Allow them to run their business, but at the same time, we need to monitor them so that they don't attempt to raise rates so high that we can't afford to even have electricity in our house. Thank you.
And Mr. Harris.
Sure. No, my record is pretty clear. You don't pick the winners and losers in renewable energy. I don't care whether that's the subsidy for ethanol or whether it's the subsidy for wind power. You know, I met with the folks who want to put the wind power off the shore. And they're like, oh, it's only $1.50 a month. The law says it limits it to only $1.50 a month for every average electric bill. That's $3 million a month over the state of Maryland. And maybe to them that's not a lot of money, but this adds up. So I'm just going to ask Mr. Smigel, and I will mention his name. In 2006, you voted for SB 154, which put us into the Regional Energy Greenhouse Gas Initiative, which actually allowed the state to increase its renewable energy, which actually increased our electric bills. Now, I got to ask, I don't know about you, my electric bill's high enough, and it should be getting lower, not higher. So I can't fathom how someone who says that they're for principle and for constitutional authority votes to increase the renewable energy standard that the government puts on an individual on their electric bill? Just a question.
Mr. Speaker.
Governor Ehrlich's administration?
Governor Ehrlich, if that was a question to me, Governor Ehrlich signed the bill. I disagree with Governor Ehrlich. I'm principle over party.
I'm just asking as to, since I have no clue, at least everything that I have brought up, I've given you in an idea. I have no clue whatsoever with 206. In 2006, 10 years ago, I've made over 20,000 votes. So I'd be glad to look at the vote and to tell you exactly what it did. And I don't even know if you voted for it since you were in there. And when we were in there together,
I did.
Excuse me, sir. I'm speaking while you're interrupting. I do remember that when I voted against in-state tuition for illegals, you voted for in-state tuition for illegals when we were in there together. So I do remember that vote. But as far as that, whatever happened in 2006 with SB 54, I don't know at this point. I'd be glad to look at the bill. And just like the last one that you tried to throw out, I gotcha, and I shot it down and said, no, you didn't get me. I'll be glad to shoot this one down too. Thank you.
I think I was mentioned since my last interruption. Yes, you did. You said I voted for something.
No.
Yes, you did. You said I voted for illegal immigration for
and I'm now. I'm glad you admitted it. Okay.
No. That I said. You said that. Now I suggest that the audience go back to the Maryland General Assembly website, look up HB 253, and look at the history of the bill and whether I voted for the bill. I did attach an amendment to the bill that added veterans, because they wanted to put the bill in to let an illegal immigrant get free in-state tuition, but not a veteran. So I did add that to the bill. But look at the final vote, HB 253. Everybody can look it up, 2003, which is actually more than 10 years ago. But you can make up your own mind on how I voted on the bill.
Come on back, and I'll show it to you.
Thank you. We're, in the interest of time, we really do have to limit this healthy but vigorous debate on this subject, but please do your homework out there in the audience. The bill's been mentioned. One last question, and we do need to be brief. Is it, and I would direct this initially to Mr. Harris, because you do have the federal experience in this respect, but any of the other candidates, if you want to briefly add in, you're welcome to. Is it true illegal aliens were given better access to health care than our veterans get from the VA? And what have you done to force a fix to the VA?
Sure, great question. It's actually not true, but illegal immigrants do get health care under EMTALA, under the federal law that says if you go to an emergency room, that emergency room has to treat you for the condition you're in. They can't send you home. They have to treat you. Now, every veteran, of course, is covered under the same law, so they get equal to that. The question is, what the heck is wrong with our VA health system? Where we tolerate a system where a veteran has to wait for months for care, or in the case of my veterans on the lower shore, have to come all the way up and cross the bridge, wait in traffic to go to the hospital, and drive past, to the veterans hospital, driving past PRMC, one of the finest, I mean, that's one of the finest hospitals in the state. So what I've done is I've gone and I've put in the recommendation that we allow our veterans a complete choice of where they get health care. You're a priority one, a priority two veteran. It's a total service disability, a majority service disability veteran. You get to choose whether you want to be in the VA system or not, or whether you just want a car just like your neighbor does that gets your care in your own community. That's the way we ought to treat our veterans. We're not treating them that way now. We should.
Any other candidates like to speak, Mr. Spiegel?
I can tell you right now, that card is not getting those veterans that care, because I get the calls for them. And if you want to know what kind of care the congressman was giving to veterans, ask him why the shore closed its only veteran center down here. Ask him why when he showed up and they asked him to come, he spent 15 minutes and then left to go bless a tractor. And then they all called me and said, what can you do, delegate, to help me, because of the congressman hasn't helped us. Ask him about the letter they sent complaining about not being able to get any help for the veterans. Ask him where are the bills that went through to try to save the Eastern Shore's ability for veterans to have a bed. It's not there. Ask him why he voted to take away a possibility that a doctor could say, I'm going to treat your PTSD with marijuana. They can't even discuss it with them. And anybody else out here can go and get that treatment, but the congressman made sure that you can't get it if you're a vet. Go ask the vets what they think of the congressman. I was in the United States Marine Corps also. That's why they call me, because I make sure that I do take care of the vets. And I got an award for being supportive of the vets. I got the Legislator of the Year from the Marine Corps League. Thank you.
Well, I guess since the former delegate mentioned me, the fact of the matter is, I guess you're talking about Royal Oak, where the people running it actually were under investigation by the federal government for running a dangerous facility. Now, I got to tell you, I think our veterans deserve the best. Not just what's out there right now, not just because it's there that you got to preserve it, they deserve the best. So we asked the VA, and they told us why they didn't relicense Royal Oak, because our veterans deserve the best. Not grandstanding. I could grandstand, I can go there, I can visit them, I can promise them anything, but I am not going to put my blessing on something that's not the best for our veterans.
Thank you. Mr. Goff?
Well, we all know that our government's starting to treat the illegals much better than our veterans, and this has got to stop. This is ridiculous. I have veterans throughout my entire family.
What would you do as a fix?
Well, we got to go in there at the VA, and we have to fire some people, that's for sure. We got to start right there. Okay? And that's all it is to it. We got to go in there and say, you're fired. Done. And replace them. They'll start right there, and then we can start going in and getting something done. Thank you.
Mr. Jackson, do you have anything?
There's a multitude of different topics that you look at in regards to that. First is the right now with welfare, you got $750 million being spent on unqualified recipients when that money could be spent on our military personnel. 20% of all our money is being spent on welfare, 18% on national defense. We could amp up the amount of money that's being put towards national defense towards our veterans. We definitely need to remove them from the veterans, the federal employee health benefits program. Again, put them into situations where they can get a government card to provide any medical and psychological treatment they need locally without having to go to the VA. The VA needs to be, again, the big government, we need to dump the VA and make them maybe a bill invoice processing center rather than dictating the medical needs of our personnel. Thank you.
Very good. Thank you very much. I'd just like to take a moment to thank the Inn at the Chesapeake Bay Beach Club for making this facility available to us. We hope that all of you will take the time, if you haven't already, to share in the dining experience here and the bar that's available, and please patronize organizations and businesses in a local area. In the interest of time, we're going to take 90 seconds for your closing statements. We said we'd be out of here at a certain time, and we want to try to keep our word. So your closing statements, and by the way, remember, early voting started today, so please make sure you get out and vote. Mr. Jackson, would you like to begin with your closing statements?
Again, I appreciate everybody taking time out of their evening this evening to come see us and have the opportunity to speak before you. Like I stated earlier in the initial discussions, that people are tired of what's going on in the status quo with Congress. 83% of voters and Americans are dissatisfied with our congressional personnel that are currently in place. That includes me. When it comes to bills like the Cromnibus bill, we should allow bills to be voted upon independently and on their own accord rather than allow for any type of bills like that to go through. We need to take care of our vets. We need a congressman that's going to be very passionate about what they do and about everything that's going on, including national security, with Syrians attempting to come into this country that are not being vetted. We need to, basically what I would love to see is to see the process of impeaching Obama. I think he's a tyrannical president. I think he's putting the livelihoods of all Americans in harm's way. He's, as it says in the Declaration of Independence, they talk about allowing large armies of foreign mercenaries into the United States. And again, that's what our Syrians are doing. And when you want to disarm America and take away our Second Amendment rights, then basically you showed us that you are a tyrannical president and we need to protect ourselves and take back our government. So I'm here to serve you. I'm here about public service. So if you want someone to help you, you need to help me. And let's take back our seat. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Jackson. Mr. Harris.
Thank you, and I want to thank the Queen Anne's County Republican Central Committee, obviously, for hosting this debate and forum. You know, I'm going to do what every incumbent does when they run for re-election. I'm going to come and ask you to send me back, do the job based on the job I've done. When I came before you again in 2008 unsuccessfully, 2010 successfully, I said I was going to go down to Washington and be a conservative the way Ronald Reagan talked about conservatism, social conservatism, fiscal conservatism, foreign policy conservatism. On all three, my record's clear. On social conservatives, as I said, on social conservatives, I've been endorsed by National Right to Life, I'm endorsed by FRC, I'm endorsed by all the social conservative groups, because I go down there and I vote for the family values that we grew up with. On the fiscal conservative, I voted each and every time, each and every year, to decrease the federal deficit, get it on track toward repaying our federal debt, and when last year they raised the deficit in the bill, I voted against it. Did exactly what I told you. I would vote to bring it down, but I'm not going to go down there and vote to bring it back up. And finally, on foreign policy, I voted for the bill that said the Syrian refugees have to be vetted before they come here. I voted to make sure that we win the war against ISIS because it's an existential threat. We haven't talked about that. We haven't talked about the fact that 200 nuclear-tipped missiles are facing us from North Korea in the hands of a madman. This is serious business. We've got to deal with it. So I'm going to ask you to go down and give me another term. And if I come back 2 years from now and I don't deliver on these promises, shame on me. And you get another crack at me. Thank you very much. Good night.
Thank you, Mr. Harris. Mr. Goff?
I want to thank Queen Anne's County for holding this event. Thank you, everybody, for showing up. I know it's a little hard for you all to sit there on those hard wooden chairs there. But again, I want to tell everybody that I worked at Bethlehem Steel. I had my own business for over 20 years. I worked thousands of people in the state of Maryland. I did not work illegals. I only worked American citizens. I'm as conservative as you can get. As far as foreign policy, I'm on the phone with France and Germany and Ukraine every weekend. I'm getting the heads up on what's really going on over there. Merkel really made a mess over there in Germany. I don't want that here in the United States. I don't even want the Syrian refugees here in the United States. And I've heard stories that the Syrian refugees don't even want to come to the United States because they don't want to leave their land. They just want to stay in Syria in a safe zone. We should provide that safe zone for them. As far as Putin, I don't trust Putin. I don't trust China. And I certainly don't trust Iran. And I think we made a bad deal. And 70% of the American people did not want that Iranian deal. But they passed it anyway. Obama's out of control. And this Congress, they have spent so much money. It's ridiculous. We're going to have to pay that back. Our grandchildren, our great-grandchildren are going to have to pay that money back. They bring in $3.2 trillion a year in the federal government. You do the math. How many years is it going to take to pay that back? Now, as far as what's happening here at home, we got to secure our borders. And I say put our troops on the borders. That's what we have our troops for. And how many agencies do we have? Obama's telling the federal government not to arrest these people. All you got to do is turn yourself in and you'll get a court date. And they don't show up for the court date.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Mr. Smigel.
Thanks, sir. I grew up a very poor family here. My mother was disabled. I was the oldest child of four. I learned very early on the value of a dollar. When I was about 12 years old, I learned you go out and you shine shoes, you sell newspapers, you bring home bread, milk, and eggs, you got breakfast, lunch, and dinner. Every job I've ever worked, I've worked two jobs. When I went through school, I paid my way through law school and college after the Marines, working midnight to eight in the mental health system and in respite care. So I understand what it's like to earn a dollar. You want somebody to go to Congress, when they look you in the eye, they're gonna go down there and they're gonna take passion with them. You've seen my passion here today. My passion on the floor of the House of Delegates when you needed somebody to stand up and be a champion for whatever causes it was. The Oath Keepers gave one A++ to everybody in the state, in the legislature. That's me, for upholding your oath to the Constitution. That's the only fidelity I have when I go there. And I will do everything in my power and use all of my passion to make sure that the Constitution's upheld and that we come back with a better way of life for everybody here in the first district, that my children, my son just graduated from college, he's out now in graduate school at Johns Hopkins, my daughter is gonna be a dancer and she's at one of the best dance schools in the world. And I wanna make sure that I give them a much better opportunity than I had growing up, and I wanna make sure that your children have the same. So I ask you, remember, Ronald Reagan would not have voted for the things that our current Congress are voting for down there. They made you promises, they didn't keep them. Two terms, too many. Send me to Congress and you'll never regret it. I'll never break my word. And you can always reach me at 410-920-0128. That's the number I always gave out and I won't change it. You won't have a problem reaching your congressman. Thank you.
Well, we'd like to thank Queen Anne's County TV for recording this. We'd like to thank the Inn at the Chesapeake Bay Beach Club for providing this facility. I'd like to thank all the candidates for coming out. I'd like to thank my fellow Republican Central Committee members. But most of all, we'd like to thank you, because without you, it doesn't work. So thank you for being a part of this. And let me just add, from what we've seen this evening, we have four high-quality candidates, each of them willing to serve you with honor and dignity. So please, make an informed choice. Please make sure you bring your neighbors out to vote, and let's make sure we send the right person to Congress. Thanks very much, and don't forget to vote.